Welcome. In this video, I will be explaining simple linear regression concepts by answering these questions about the relationship between apartment size and monthly rent. Part A. To identify the independent variable, it's often helpful to first determine the dependent variable. In this scenario, we're looking at how monthly rent relates to apartment size. Logically, we will expect rent to depend on the size of the apartment, and not the other way around. Moreover, our goal is to predict monthly rental cost. In statistics, the variable we're trying to predict is typically the dependent variable. Therefore, we conclude that the dependent variable y is monthly rent and the independent variable x is apartment size. Remember, the independent variable is the one we use to predict or explain the changes in the dependent variable. In this case, we're using apartment size to predict monthly rent. Next, to determine the regression equation, we can use these formulas to obtain the slope and the y-intercept, but we use data analysis in Excel to generate a more detailed regression output. Here in Excel, I'm going to first create a scatter plot. Select the entire data, ensure the x variable is on the left, click Insert, and select Scatter. Right-click on any of the dots and add trend line. To generate the regression output, click the Data tab. You should see Data Analysis to the right here. If it's not there, right-click on the ribbon and click Customize the ribbon. Click Add-ins under Excel Options. Then with Add-ins selected at the bottom here, click Go. Select Analysis Tool Pack. Click OK. Now click the Data tab, click Data Analysis, scroll down, and select Regression. Click OK. For input Y range, select the dependent variable data. For input X range, select the independent variable data. I'm going to check labels because I included the titles in the selection. If I want residual output, I can select any of these boxes here. But I'm just going to click OK. And here's the regression summary output. Now, back to our presentation. From the output, we see the y-intercept here as 974.426, denoted by B0. And the slope B1 of 1.031 is given here beside the x variable description. The estimated regression equation can thus be given as shown here. Note that the hat on the y indicates that this is the predicted value of y. The actual value of y is denoted simply as y. Next, we interpret the value of the slope. The slope represents the expected change in y, monthly rent, for a 1-unit increase in x, apartment size. In this relationship, the slope indicates that for each additional square foot of apartment size, monthly rent is expected to increase by approximately $1.03 on average. Alternatively, we can say that for every 100 square foot increase in apartment size, monthly rent is expected to increase by about $103 on average. Next, we interpret the value of the y-intercept. The y-intercept represents the predicted value of y, monthly rent, when x, apartment size, is 0. In this context, the intercept suggests that an apartment with 0 square feet would rent for about $974.43 per month. However, this lacks practical meaning because 1. An apartment cannot have 0 square feet. 2. The value of 0 is far outside the range of apartment sizes in our data set. Therefore, while mathematically correct, the intercept in this regression equation should not be interpreted literally. Next, to predict monthly rental cost for a 1200 square foot apartment, we substitute 1200 for x in the regression equation. And that gives about $2211. Note that it will be inappropriate to use this model to predict rent for a 5000 square foot apartment, since 5000 is outside the range of our data values. Next, we calculate the residual for the second observation. Note that it has an x value of 990 and a y value of 1860. Substituting x equals 990 into our regression equation, we obtain a predicted rent value y hat of approximately 1995. Now, to find the residual, we subtract the predicted value from the actual value. That's y minus y hat, or 1860 minus 1995, giving us negative 135. This negative residual tells us that our model overestimated the rent for this particular data point. If you look at the graph, you'll notice that this point falls below the regression line, which visually confirms our residual calculation. Next, we determine and interpret the correlation coefficient R, also called Pearson's R. In Excel, we can use equals correl function to calculate the correlation coefficient. However, we also find this value displayed as multiple R in the regression output. Note that this multiple R is always positive in the output, even when there is a negative correlation present. This can be a bit misleading, but there's a way to clarify what the true sign should be. The slope of the regression line and the correlation coefficient always have the same sign. To determine the true sign of R, simply check the sign on the slope. If the slope is positive, then R would also be positive. If the slope is negative, R would be negative as well. In our case, the correlation coefficient is positive 0.847, since the slope is positive. This indicates a strong positive linear relationship between the two variables. In this context, a correlation of 0.847 suggests that as apartment size increases, monthly rents tend to increase as well. The closer R is to plus 1 or negative 1, the stronger the linear relationship between the two variables. With a value of 0.847 being close to 1, we can confidently say there is a strong correlation here. Remember, correlation does not imply causation, so we won't say large apartments cause higher prices. But we can say that larger apartments tend to have higher prices. Next, we determine and interpret the coefficient of determination R squared. To calculate R squared, we can simply square the correlation coefficient R. We can also find it directly in the output here as R squared, which is approximately 0.717 or 71.7%. What does this mean? The R squared value tells us the proportion of variation in the dependent variable, in our case monthly rent, that can be explained by the independent variable, apartment size. That is, about 71.7% of the variation in monthly rent can be explained by the variation in apartment size. In other words, knowing the size of the apartment allows us to account for about 71.7% of the differences we see in monthly rents. Since our R squared is close to 1, it suggests that apartment size is a useful predictor of monthly rent and a good fit of the regression line to the data. Note, however, that there is still about 28.3% of the variation in rent that is not explained by apartment size alone. This remaining variation could be due to other factors such as the location, amenities, or property condition. We now determine the standard error of the estimate and interpret its meaning in this context. We can calculate it using formula or in Excel using the function STEYX. We can also find the standard error directly in our regression output as 179.54. It is essentially the standard deviation of the residuals. It's an estimate of the average distance between each data point and our regression line. In this context, this 179.54 represents the average difference between the actual monthly rent and the rents predicted by our model. In essence, on average, our model's prediction of monthly rent may be off by about $180 in either direction. This means that if a model predicts a rent of $2,000 for an apartment, the actual rent is likely to fall somewhere between $1,820 and $2,180 on average. Compared to actual rent values, this standard error is fairly small, indicating that the model does not fit poorly. Next, we construct a 95% confidence interval for the slope coefficient. We can use this formula to determine the lower and upper limit of the confidence interval, where B1 is the sample slope here, T is the T critical value with n minus 2 degrees of freedom, not the T stat shown here. SEB1 is the standard error of the slope given here in the output, which can also be calculated using this formula. Moreover, we can find the lower and upper limits of the confidence interval directly in our regression output here. To interpret these results, we can say we are 95% confident that in the population, the slope lies between 0.5748 and 1.4873. That is, for every square foot increase in apartment size, the predicted value of rent increases between $0.57 and $1.49. Finally, let's test the significance of the slope at 5% significance level. Our goal is to determine if a significant linear relationship exists between apartment size and monthly rent, with alpha set at 0.05. The null hypothesis H0 states that no linear relationship exists between the two variables. In other words, the slope is zero. We express this as beta 1 equals 0, where beta 1 is the population slope. The alternative hypothesis HA or H1 states that a linear relationship does exist, meaning the slope is not equal to 0. We write this as beta 1 not equal to 0. We'll conduct a t-test for this analysis, but it's worth noting that an f-test will lead us to the same conclusion. And the same conclusion will be reached if we conduct a test for the population correlation coefficient. Looking at our regression output, we find the t-statistic for testing the relationship is 5.035, which is the slope coefficient divided by the standard error of the slope. The corresponding p-value is 0.00051. which is substantially smaller than our significance level of 0.05, suggesting we should reject the null hypothesis. Based on this evidence, we can conclude that the slope is indeed not equal to zero. In practical terms, this means there is a significant linear relationship between apartment size and monthly rent. Remember, while this test tells us the relationship is significant, it doesn't tell us about the strength of that relationship. That's what our earlier analysis of R and R squared were for. And that's it for this video. Thanks for watching.